there is a particular math concept that is so fundamental, so essential, so powerful, that, once understood, will completely change the way you interpret counting problems and what it means to count. Curious? Let's begin with a basic problem to demonstrate the concept. I have an auditorium with 100 seats. Every seat is filled by exactly one person, and no one is left without a seat. How many people are in the auditorium? It should be quite evident that there are the same number of seats as there are people, and so there are 100 people. We don't even need to count the number of people to get our answer. Let's now explain what our concept is. Notice that we have two sets, a set of seats and a set of people. We then found a pairing of the items in these two sets, such that everything has exactly one thing paired to it. This is called a bijection. It's a fancy word, but that's all it means, a one-to-one and onto pairing of items between two sets. Let's now go over the major reasons why bijections are so important. Firstly, bijections are fundamental to counting. It is not possible to count at all unless you use a bijection. Take a look at the circles on the screen. How would you show me how many there are? You'd probably do this. Point to each circle while counting up. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. But look what you've done. You've assigned a counting number to each of the circles. The reason why there are 5 circles is because there is a bijection between the set of circles and the set of counting numbers up to 5. There is no possible way to tell that there are exactly 5 circles without implicitly applying a bijection like this. Without bijections, counting is impossible. More directly, we can say that bijections are how we define counting. Secondly, bijections are essential to any counting problem, as it is how we check our answer. Making sure your answer is correct and free of mistakes is important, but unlike algebra problems, we can't check our answer by simply plugging a value of x into an equation. So what would we do to check the answer to a counting problem then? There are two kinds of mistakes that can be made in a counting problem, overcounting and undercounting. Let's see what these two mistakes look like. Here are our 5 circles from before. Overcounting can look like this, where we assign multiple numbers to the same circle. Undercounting can look like this, where there are circles that don't have a number assigned. Here's a question for you. Let's say we undercounted, and then we fixed our undercounting mistake. Is our answer now correct? If you said yes, you have fallen into one of the most common counting traps. Take a look at this assignment of numbers with circles. Clearly, we have undercounted because we missed this circle. However, fixing it does not give us the right answer, as we have overcounted too. This tells us that it is possible to overcount and undercount at the same time. So whenever we check our counting answers, we have to check both overcounting and undercounting. It is never enough just to check and fix one of them. Always check for both overcounting and undercounting. Once we are certain we have not overcounted and we have not undercounted, we guarantee that our list has a one-to-one pairing with our counting numbers, which, by definition, is a bijection. This teaches us that we have two ways of checking our answer to a counting problem. Either find a bijection, or prove that there is no overcounting and there is no undercounting. You don't need to do both, as they are by definition equivalent. Last but not least, bijections can be a powerful problem-solving tool that can turn very difficult counting problems into easy counting problems. In the previous video, we counted the number of ways to walk along the lines of a grid. If you haven't watched it yet, I highly recommend that you do. Link is in the description. To count the paths using combinations, we used a bijection. We had a list of paths and a list of step sequences, and we paired them up in a one-to-one fashion. The paths were very difficult to count, but the step sequences were much easier, and so in this way, we transformed a hard problem into an easier one. Let's now apply what we learned to a classic counting problem. How many numbers are in this list, where the difference between adjacent terms is always 7? Listing all of the numbers out one by one and counting them manually is not a good option. It would take too long, and we could easily miscount, with no way to verify whether or not we made a mistake. One way to solve this problem is to notice that this is an arithmetic sequence and use a formula. Here is the general formula. Applying the formula, we first find the difference between the first and last numbers, then divide the common difference, which is 7 in this case, and finally add 1. Wait, why is there a plus 1 at the end? Most people don't know about the plus 1 and get a wrong answer. Even if you know why it's there, you may occasionally forget. Using this formula is not ideal, because we would have to understand or memorize this formula in order to use it without making a mistake. In addition, this is a very specific formula that only works for arithmetic sequences. If our sequence behaved differently, like this one for example, then our formula completely fails. Now let's take a look at how we could solve it much more easily using bijections. We first take each number in our first list and subtract 37. Forming a second list. This forms a bijection between the first list and second list, because each number in the first list can be paired with a number that is 37 less in the second list. Notice that we can count this new list instead of the original list, as they have the same amount of numbers, and we know this thanks to our bijection. We can then continue to make another bijection by dividing all of our numbers by 7. Finally, we will make one more bijection by adding 1 to each number. Since the last list is made up of our counting numbers, the last number is our answer. This is just one of an infinite number of ways to solve this using bijections. No matter how many bijections or what bijections we make, we always eventually end up with the list at the bottom, and we will have the correct answer in a way that we can verify and prove our answer is correct. No formula needed. But it gets better. Look at the last numbers of each of the lists we made, and try to follow the rules we used to get from one list to another. This is exactly the formula we used before. Not only does the bijection method demonstrate why the plus 1 is necessary in the formula, it also means that we never need to memorize this formula in the first place, because the bijection method can be used to just derive the formula. So what did we learn? Firstly, bijections are how we define counting. Secondly, they are an extremely versatile and powerful problem-solving tool we can use to solve really hard counting problems by converting them into easier problems. Next, making sure we haven't overcounted and making sure we haven't undercounted is essentially the same as finding a bijection. And lastly, it is the method by which we check and verify our answers in counting problems. Alternatively, just check for both overcounting and undercounting. I have to come clean. This video was a bit of a trick. The main lesson of this video isn't about the bijections themselves, but about teaching us the right mentality and habits when it comes to tackling counting problems. Bijections as a concept might be cool and inspiring, but now we will translate our lessons into something practical, something that will make you a better mathematician. Now that we know what bijections are, we can approach counting problems more methodically. For starters, we need to get into the mindset of checking and verifying our answers to counting problems, just as we do with any other math problem. Secondly, it teaches us why we need to be extremely careful when applying formulas to counting and what we can do about it. Using bijections, we can now verify the formulas that we use. This will prevent us from memorizing the formula wrong in some cases because we can simply derive them again. But more importantly, it prevents us from making a much more common mistake, applying the formulas incorrectly. Like everything else in math and life, focused guided practice is the real key to improvement. Knowing these concepts is only the first step, but solving problems on your own is necessary to get into good habits and get a feel for how to apply these ideas in practice. If you want to learn more, please hit like, subscribe to my channel, and share this video. I hope to see you all next time.